Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for All About Android is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of All About Android is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. Rocket Mortgage brings the mortgage process into the 21st century with a fast, easy, and completely online process. Check out Rocket Mortgage today at quickenloans.com/android. And by Tracker. Tracker makes losing things a thing of the past. Pair Tracker to your smartphone, attach it to any item, and find its precise location with the tap of a button. Visit thetracker.com right now and enter promo code AAA for 30% off your entire order. Welcome to another episode of All About Android. This is episode 273, recorded on Tuesday, July 5th, 2016. We're your weekly source for the latest news, hardware, and apps for the Android faithful. I'm Jason Howell.
Nice. Florence Ion.
Hello, Florence Ion. From the other side of the country. I was there yesterday at the other side of the country.
The other side of the kitchen.
Oh, okay. The OTK or something. I don't know. That actually doesn't work. It's good to see you. I'm sorry that you can't be in studio. I'm also sorry because we don't have Ron here. No Ron.
I know. Well, Ron, I don't feel he's on a beach somewhere, so.
Is he? I didn't realize this. That makes me feel even worse. I want to be on a beach right now.
I know. That's why I don't feel so bad.
Okay, yeah. Never mind. I'm not going to feel bad. I'm just going to feel bad that he isn't here offering his insight. But we do have an awesome guest. And actually, I'm amazed that it's been as long as it has. Russell Hawley, this time joining from VRheads.com. How's it going, Russell? It's great to have you here.
Thank you. It is great to be here.
Yeah, managing editor for VRheads.com. So last time you were on, it was last year. Man, I think it's been like 9 months or something like that. Anyways, obviously we've had you on plenty of times, and AndroidCentral.com was in your lower third. Now we've got a new site. So tell us a little bit about VRheads.
Well, this is a new opportunity to kind of explore all the crazy new things that are happening in virtual reality right now. There are so many. It doesn't really matter if you're powering it with a smartphone or with a super powerful computer or very soon a PlayStation 4. There's just a lot of really cool things happening, you know, apps, games, developers that had never previously done anything before, cooking up, you know, kind of new and fascinating ways to play games. It's a really cool thing to just kind of absorb right now.
Yeah, and early on in the kind of, we were talking about this a little bit in the pre-show. It's not like VR is a new thing necessarily, but it has a lot of fire under it right now. And kind of getting in, you know, while there's a lot of, you know, kind of a growing fan base for this technology, definitely a good position for you as managing editor of this stuff. But I have to imagine it's a lot of fun too, because you just get to play around with all this stuff.
It's so much fun. And, you know, even though, like, you know, the idea behind virtual reality is definitely not new, but developers have come in and really come up with really cool new ideas for playing games using this technology. You know, what happens if you can, you know, climb a mountain and have it actually feel like you're doing that, or fire arrows, like you're actually, you know, reaching behind you and drawing arrows and firing. And it ends up creating really kind of compelling, not just games, but apps as well.
Yeah. Very cool stuff. Oh, okay. So Ghostbuster VR, you were talking about this a little bit. I haven't seen any of the clips. Is this your latest jam? This is what you've been playing with?
This was actually something I can't do at home. It can only happen right now at Madame Tussauds in New York. It is a special experience that they have set up. And I went with Michael Fisher to go and check it out, where you feel like you're walking around with a proton pack, you know, on your back, multiplayer, you know, walk around with these VR headsets, and you can kind of walk around and you know, catch ghosts and the whole point. They called this hyper reality, which sounded like a really silly buzzword, right up until we blew up the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man and I could smell burnt marshmallow in the room.
No way. That's awesome.
Like, they actually set it up so that you could do that. There was another part where like the wall of the apartment that we were standing in got ripped away and all this cold air came rushing in and hit our skin. They you know, it was just all of this stuff to make it feel like you were, you know, actually part of the thing that you were seeing through virtual reality. It was really intense.
Now, this is not, I think maybe I missed it. Is this The Void or this is something like The Void?
This is made by The Void.
Okay.
The Void and Sony, you know, worked together to have this ready for Madame Tussauds for their new Ghostbusters exhibit that's there in Times Square.
Oh my God, this sounds so awesome.
It was really incredible. Like, it was nothing I had ever done before prepared me for how cool that was to smell toasted marshmallow when you blew up the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. That was pretty ridiculous.
I could kind of imagine like one of the employees at the side with a big marshmallow and a lighter just waiting for the right moment. Okay, now. That's really cool. Excellent stuff. Check out VRheads.com if you are interested in VR stuff and seeing what the future is like, because it's going to get kind of crazy, I think. Over the next couple of years, we're going to see a lot of really cool stuff. And I don't know. I'm happy that we're there now, because ever since like Lawnmower Man back when I was younger, it's like, this is going to be cool. The future is going to be awesome. So it's awesome that you get to be managing editor of the future, basically. That might be overstating it a little bit.
Jeez.
No, I'll take
more or less. More or less is true, right?
Supreme overlord of the future. I'll accept it.
Was that overstating it, Flo? I'm sorry.
No, I thought it was cute. Thought it was great. That's a great way to put it.
I want to give you a title from the future, too. We'll work on that throughout this episode. We'll figure it out.
My name is Flo. You got it already.
Okay. All right. That works. Hey, we've got a lot of Android things to talk about. We've got a little bit of VR stuff to talk about. That's later in the show. But we're going to be discussing the long-awaited announcement of Android N's real name. And oh my goodness, for the first time ever, I completely forgot to get the actual dessert. That's okay. We'll figure it out for next week. Huawei and its murky marketing of the P9. That's a very interesting story. What we think we know about the Galaxy Note 7. Google's, let's see here. Oh, sorry, not Google's, but we've got Pokemon Go just releasing. We've got all sorts of stuff we're going to talk about this week and a whole lot more. Let's jump right into the news.
If you smell burnt marshmallow, don't worry. We're working on Smell-O-Vision. Mm. It's time for Android News.
Or I think what would have been really...
do you have a better one?
Well, no. Okay. I think you did well with what you had, because we hadn't announced the name of the next version.
Yeah.
You could have worked Nougat in there a little bit, because that is the name. And, you know, this is kind of like at the top of everyone's list for the most part, that and Nutella. But Android Nougat, Android version N, and it has the little Android guy standing on top of three little blocks of nougat that, I'm sorry, just do not look yummy to me.
They get stuck in your teeth. you will need to develop a better relationship with your dentist after downloading this version of Android. Mm. It's possible it will be very hard to bite into.
Yeah, that's what I fear. That's what I fear. I don't know. Nougat I've always thought of as a nice component to some candy bars, I suppose, but not a feature presentation.
See, that's what I got in trouble for.
Snickers. Yes, not a feature presentation.
Yep, that's what I got in trouble for when they first made the announcement. I said, isn't this an ingredient and not... And I got a whole bunch of people on Twitter yelled at me because how dare I not know that this was a standalone candy that you can go and buy? I had no idea.
I didn't know.
But maybe that's the whole point, though. Oh. Maybe the point is that this version of Android is not the main event. It's just
filled with
ingredients to the future.
So you're saying that this version of Android is going to be important to the appreciation of the next version of Android.
Yes, precisely. Kind of like how... what was the version before? I think Kit Kat. Kind of like how Kit Kat was to lollipop and marshmallow. Just like a jumping off point, an introduction to the future of Android.
But Kit Kat as a treat is very good standalone. So I would argue that to my death.
It is. Nougat... Although they do suggest you... break off a piece and share it.
Yeah, although sometimes I like to keep it all whole and just bite through the whole thing. Just whine it, because you're not supposed
to. How you eat a Kit Kat, but whatever you do at home is your own thing, man.
So, sorry, did I reveal too much about my Kit Kat eating habits? I'm really sorry that got awkward. I think this might be the first year where we've made the dessert announcement or the treat announcement on the show and not had the actual treat to enjoy. A, it would just be me eating it, and B, I'm just not a fan of nougat like by itself, so I'm kind of okay with that. Although I feel like we have to do it eventually as a rite of passage.
No, we do. Let's listen. I'll be back next week. I'll go. I have to go find some nougat, because the thing is, like, it's not an easy thing to find. You're like, hey, can I get some nougat? I'm like, I have some in my freezer because we bought some when we went to Italy a couple years ago, but it's
I don't know, exactly.
I'm not going to bring that to share with you.
It's like one of those desserts that like you get when you're traveling somewhere and you're in the airport and you're about to leave and you're like, oh, I didn't get anything to take home.
Exactly.
Yeah, that box of nougat.
I didn't get anything as a gift. That's a gift you buy your parents.
Yeah.
When you visit Europe. Nougat.
Okay, so then, Russell, we have a few different pronunciations. These are the really hardcore, like, important things that we talk about on this show. We have a couple of different pronunciations that I've heard already. I'm saying nougat. You're, Flo, I feel like you're saying something more along the lines of, like, nugget or something. Or
nougat. Nougat.
Nougat. Nougat. Nougat. What do you, where do you side, Russell?
I'm down with the name that I've gotten from Snickers commercials my entire life, which is Nougat.
Nougat. Okay.
I'm going to lean on that one.
Okay.
I think that's right.
Also overly pronounce my G's. I have like a problem with that for whatever reason.
Good.
Whatever.
Yeah, it is what it is. I think it was the obvious choice. I didn't think that Google was going to go with the branded choice. I just don't know if we're going to see that again. Maybe with O. I don't know. But Nougat, I suppose, makes sense. But there was this article on Android Central because, as we know, the minute that a new Android version is announced, people start talking about what the next version is going to be named. It's just the way it is in Android world. And there's a great post on Android Central by Alex Dovey, who basically just picks it all apart. Ox tongue pastry. I didn't know that was a thing. This would potentially be Android 8.0.
It was really bad. Yeah.
It doesn't look very good. I mean, just the name itself just kind of, I don't know. Yeah,
let's go ahead and I'll pronounce that one.
I mean, you know, good for international, I suppose. Olibol. Come on, let's get to ones we recognize. Ozark pudding, don't know. Oatmeal cookie, I would eat that. Oralettes, I don't know. Oreo, I think Oreo is the one that people are going to keep pointing to because it's the most obvious.
I think it's especially important to read the description there where Alex says that Oreos are not tasty.
Mm. Yeah, you know what? I don't agree with him. I agree to disagree.
Yeah, he says right down there the rating.
Yeah,
the cookie itself tastes like nothing. I'm ashamed to know you, Alex.
I don't understand that. It doesn't taste like nothing though. It tastes like an Oreo.
Tastes like chocolate. Yeah.
It tastes like deliciousness.
I was embarrassed to know him when I read that.
Yeah, that's a tough one. I don't know. So, anyways, we've got the names are kind of spread on a table on a delicious platter, and we're going to have to think about this for the next year. But we
Jason,
know that N
like
is nougat.
I feel like you're very underwhelmed by this entire thing.
I
feel like I can sense it through the computer.
Well, part of that is that I've been gone for a week, and it's really hard for me to come back to work after a week away. It's like my brain is like kind of having a hard time adjusting to the fact that I was just like by a pool all week. And
okay, well, I was trying to project my feelings onto you.
Yeah. Okay.
Not that I feel it's like very, it's a very underwhelming. Like I don't know how it's gonna sound.
Yeah.
Writing it with every like review that I do, I don't know what it's gonna happen when I explain to people that Nougat is the name of the next version of Android. Like at least Marshmallow's kind of cutesy, but
yeah, right. Kit Kat felt very weird for a long time, and then it felt kind of normal. I think it just after a while, it just kind of becomes what it is, and we're in the new phase of nougat, N-E-W, not N-O-U.
We're in the acceptance phase.
What's that?
We're in the acceptance phase.
Yes, exactly. we're having a hard time adjusting, but we'll get there. We'll get there. There's 10 steps, and we'll get there eventually.
You said you didn't care for the statue either.
He's just kind of like standing on a couple of blocks of nougat. Here I am. Hey.
Instead of standing there holding a marshmallow or standing there holding a lollipop?
Yeah, I don't know. It feels a little less integrated. It feels like we had this thing, we had these things. Let's just go like that.
Well, I think that's been like the last couple of generations. Yeah. And I think that's all Google's primary focus on making the Android brand like the thing.
Yeah, well, see, but there, Brian, he's holding it. He's holding it. He's not just standing on a platform.
Well, the bars were too big for him to hold.
Yeah.
Nougat is really dense, so I don't think
it would be too heavy.
Be easy to carry.
Yeah, it's true. Good point. I understand now what Google was
thinking. You should thoroughly analyze how this candy works and how the Android figurine would hold it.
Exactly. It's one of the first desserts that when I look at it, I don't go, I want to have that and eat it. So there we go. That's our thoughts on one single topic, but it's guaranteed to come up at least once a year when we finally find out what the next version is named. There you go. It's Nougat. Moving on, Flo, what is the next story?
The next story has to do with Brexit. Yep.
Oh,
we're talking about Brexit.
That's fun.
But not completely, because we are talking about the OnePlus 3, which beginning July 11th, the OnePlus 3 price in British pounds will jump from £309 to £329. £20, pretty significant in a sense. Mm-hmm. OnePlus took to its forums last week to warn of the potential price hike, thanks to the shaky financial state of the UK, you know, in light of the Brexit vote. It still costs £309 until July 11th, so if you really want to get it for $20 less, you can buy it now. But honestly, guys, I think this was just a slight marketing ploy to try and sell a couple more OnePlus 3s. Yes, I'm going to say it. I'm just going to come out and say it. I really feel like this is capitalizing on the entire Brexit scandal.
Interesting.
Well, that's just their entire business model, so you're probably right.
That's just how they work.
Me immediately.
Man, you know, when I read it, I was kind of like, well, you know, like all businesses have to ask themselves this. I don't know how much £20 per device shifts the economics of their business model. But I guess when I read it, I was kind of like, oh, you know, they're letting people know. I just didn't think of it as an opportunistic grab. But I guess in light of their history, I can understand why you might think that. What do you think, Russell?
Well, it's like, what, £20? Oh, sorry, no. Russell, I totally interrupted you. But I was going to say it's like, what, £20, which is like, what, before the EU vote, it was maybe 30 $5?
Yeah, I may have had some sort of sense or an idea of that before everything happened, but now I just don't know anymore. Bleak says it's the lowest value since the 80s, so a lot lower. I don't know. Do you think this was an opportunistic grab, Russell, or do you think this was fair?
On the one hand, price is a big contending point for this phone and this company. You know, so giving a warning when you give a kind of price hike seems appropriate. But giving a warning and then saying, so you have 2 weeks to go and buy the phone right now, seems a little more like an attention grab than it does, you know, letting your users know what's going on.
You guys, that headline, hard choices need to be made. The hard choice, I think, right now is whether or not Britain is going to leave the EU. Not whether or not you're going to pay 20 extra pounds for your phone, but that's just me.
Or
that's just my opinion.
I'm with Flo on this one.
Yeah. Okay. I feel like I'm normally I would be on the other side of the fence on this one when it comes to OnePlus, but for some reason I was kind of like, oh yeah, okay, they're doing what they feel like they need to do.
I just kind of appreciate the opportunity to talk about Brexit and just bring it up again. And
All right.
You know, remind everybody that it's actually happening and we should all probably be running in a panic. But
it's still happening and it's still terrible.
It's still a thing. Yes. Man. Yeah, that's another way that vacation was really nice. Not following a lot of that stuff. And other things here on our own U.S. turf. But anyways, also, while I was gone, I've been living life in two-factor land. That's pretty cool. And actually, as you can see, I still have the OnePlus 3. I'm still using that. But you guys talked about it a little bit. I don't know. Did you go into much detail on the whole thing that happened? Probably don't need to show this right now.
Ron talked about your side of the coin a little bit last week and sort of like explained what happened. And we had some viewer mail,
yes, okay,
that had come in. about two-factor authentication. I don't know. Would you still like suggest it after
Absolutely.
The ordeal that you had?
Yes.
Would you say that the ordeal that you had and how difficult it was to set everything back up shows how two-factor is absolutely like the best way to protect things?
I don't know. That's a hard question to answer because I've thought about that. And I'm like, well, that would be the case if I never got back into my account, but I did. And I mean, believe me, I'm really happy that I did. I did not want to lose my Google account.
Authentic. I mean, you were the legitimate holder of the account, and you had to email right. Google and say, listen, I'm the legitimate holder of the account.
Yeah, and I mean, there was pretty obvious proof that it had happened in my account and all that, because it happened literally on This Week in Google during the show.
You're right. You had physical evidence.
It would have been a pretty elaborate like hoax for me to like try and gain access to somebody else's account by, filling in for Leo on his show and staging that. So I had obvious, backup to support it. But then I'm like, okay, yeah, but I had to fill out like a questionnaire online, which some of the questions were actually kind of difficult. You have to tell Google, at what, when did you sign up for Gmail approximately? And they ask like all of these like targeted questions like that to get a sense of, I imagine, how many of them you actually get close to right, because you're not going to get all of them right. Or maybe you will. Maybe you have way.
Gmail.
Exactly. I mean,
I have no idea. It was between like junior and senior year of college.
So like, you just say that.
Possibly.
I don't know. Junior, senior year of college. But, none of those things are questions that are impossible for someone to guess if they really wanted to get a hold of it. Having said that, I trust Google to know, their processes well enough to know that they can, say more confidently that this person is who they claim they are and do the reversal. And I'm very fortunate and happy for that they were able to do that, because the thought of losing my Google account after all this time, like, The more I lived with that idea, the more devastating it seemed. When I came home that night and I told my wife what happened, her very first question was, what about our photos? And I was like, oh, crap, what about our photos? I didn't think about that. So, what it taught me is just how much, especially considering what we do with Android and Google and all this kind of stuff, like we live inside Google services. And it's like we're all in at this point. Most people that probably follow this show are probably in the same boat. So when you really consider the idea of like losing all of that, boop, it's erased. You'll never have access to it again. That's a scary thought. There's a lot of implications to something like that. But
also,
yes,
I have a lot of redundancy though.
Well, yes.
Just in case, things really do get absolutely terrible. Like at least I have something backed up somewhere else. So I have to worry so much about it going into the void.
Yeah. I mean, other lessons, the Scooter X points this out in the chat. Make sure and you read all the things that they tell you when you're signing up for two-factor, because there is on the very first page a small gray text. Now, mind you, it's like a light gray text on a white background, and it's a pretty small font that says don't use Google Voice number for this sign-up process. Easy to not see. If I was doing the two-factor sign-up and not doing a show, I probably would have saw it. But in my rush to, show how easy it is to sign up for two-factor, I didn't. And obviously, that was a big mistake on my part. So I don't think that the lesson is necessarily don't use Google Voice in this regard. But for that part, don't use Google Voice. Because there were a lot of people that said, well, I use Google Voice and I don't have any problems. So there's obviously reasons to. So once the account was kind of reversed, I did it the right way. I made sure I wasn't doing a show when I signed up for two-factor, and I got signed up, and I've been using it ever since. And I think my fear going into two-factor was that it would be incredibly inconvenient and complicated. Like, I didn't understand the amount of times that I would actually have to use it, right? And what it turns out in practice is you're authorizing a device one time, more or less. I think you can change the settings so that you authorize all the time if you want. But you can set it up. So if you have a desktop at home and you never worry about, somebody in a coffee shop getting into your desktop computer at home, then you can authorize it once and have that just always have access. And so there's ways around it and makes it easier. So I'm very happy to be protected by two-factor. I'm happy that I'm not afraid of it. And I'm very, very fortunate and thankful that I have access to my Google account again. Russell, I have to imagine that you've at least considered two-factor. Do you use two-factor? What's your experience been?
I use two-factor for everything. If two-factor authentication is enabled on a service, then I turn it on immediately.
Mm-hmm.
It's just something that I've always done. Security is kind of by nature inconvenient.
Yeah.
It kind of has to be. And social engineering is increasingly a way of penetration into accounts and stuff like that, mm-hmm. Which is one of the big reasons I'm a huge fan of the research being done at Google's ATAP division for Project Abacus, I think it's called. For kind of password replacement by just this massive string of mm-hmm. bio cues and things like that. I'm a huge fan of seeing that, you know, become a reality.
Right. Yep. Opening up alternative ways of logging and not requiring. I've been using Authenticator as my kind of, my point of getting the code. You can choose to do it a number of ways. You can get, you know, a message sent to you via SMS, which I did initially, and then I switched to Authenticator. Apparently, I have to check out Authy, so I got to find time to do that because it has its own benefits. So there's a whole other world in there, a whole bunch of layers in there to kind of explore. But I feel better now that it's protected. Somebody in chat just said, I have not mentioned exactly how I got access. And I think that's actually important. Well, it's obviously very important to the story, which is that really my doing it on the show that I do did nothing more than speed the process along. But the process would be the same for everyone, which is when you sign up, there's a little link on the sign-up page where you can click when it says you're having trouble signing into your account. And it'll give you some options as far as like, how are you, you know, having trouble? And there's some options there for, you know, two-factor authentication not working or whatever. And if you go through that process, then you'll get the questionnaire that I was talking about. And it's a really long, like page after page after page questionnaire that you fill out that basically tells Google, hopefully, that you are who you say you are. And that sends it off to them. 3 to 5 business days, they say they're going to review it. They'll be in contact with you and kind of verify certain things. So my doing it here was not the reason that it happened. The reason that it happened is because I did the form and that's the process. They were just able to speed it along a little bit quicker. It was like 2 days instead of 3 to 5. So that was better. But there you go. Happy to be doing it now. And hopefully I didn't scare anyone away from two-factor because I think it's actually pretty darn important.
Well, you scared me a little bit. But
yeah, I know I did scare people, but it's okay. I also proved that it's not the end of the world.
That's also true.
I suppose. All right. That is that. Let's take a break and thank one of the sponsors of today's episode. That is Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. Me and my family, we bought a house a couple of years ago. One thing I can tell you from my experience is that securing that mortgage, the loan, it's a process that takes a lot of time, a lot of planning. You got to dig out paperwork from who knows, you know, when or where, organizing all that information, answering really targeted questions. It's all very important to the process. It's a mortgage after all, but it wasn't easy. And anything that'll make that process easier is going to kind of take some stress off your shoulders, that associated stress that comes with it. Rocket Mortgage brings the mortgage approval process into the 21st century. It's fast, powerful, and completely online. Rocket Mortgage has taken all the complicated, time-consuming parts of applying for a mortgage out of the equation. So if you hate searching through stacks of old files and paperwork, that's why you want to check out Rocket Mortgage. With Rocket Mortgage, you can easily share your bank statements, your pay stubs at the touch of a button, helping you get approved in minutes for a custom mortgage solution that's been tailored to your unique financial situation. Even better, with Rocket Mortgage, you can do all of this on your phone or your tablet. Do it on your own terms. It's a quick online process that you can manage from the convenience of your couch, wherever you happen to be sitting, actually. So if you're looking to refinance your mortgage or buy a home, check out Rocket Mortgage today at quickenloans.com/android. That's quickenloans.com/android. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, nmlsconsumeraccess.org. That's nmlsconsumeraccess.org, number 3030. And we thank Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans for their support of All About Android. All right, we've got some cool, interesting stuff in hardware. Let's check it out. All right, Flo, we got some shakeups in the OEM world right now.
We got some sad news, actually. This is sad to me. So Dell is getting out of the Android game for now as it stopped production of its Venue tablets, as well as halted operating system upgrades for current users. That is a total bummer for anybody who has the Dell Venue tablets that were actually quite awesome. They scored nicely.
Yeah, I reviewed... Yeah. Okay. So did you do their last one? I think it was the 7,000, the Dell Venues, or what was it?
I didn't say the name of it because I didn't want to screw up the name.
The Venue 8 7000.
Venue 8 7000. Yeah. Yes, I did review. That was actually a great tablet. But I completely understand why they're getting out of the game because, you know, the Slate tablet, it's not really in demand as much as it used to be. You know, sales are down. People aren't going out. You know, once you get a tablet, you kind of hold on to it for a couple of years and makes sense. But it's not like, I mean, I feel like they weren't doing very much marketing around it anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. Somebody in the chat was like, Dell's still in the Android game? Really? Because, it's not a prominent necessarily player.
Yeah. But then we got a couple other shakeups in the LG round. And I totally was just like, LG's got no chill. which is a thing the millennials say. The latest flagship, the LG G5, is apparently not selling all that well. Uh-huh. And so the company yesterday, actually, 4th of July, a holiday over here, laid off some of its executives as part of the mobile team as it tries to rebuild new momentum with this mobile effort. So trying to put new people at the helm to try and turn around the business, make things go a little more smoothly. LG says that the changes are meant to keep the division afloat in light of challenging market situations.
Apologize for the missing K there.
That's all right. I don't actually know what you meant to say with that, but I read the typo out loud, so I hope everyone enjoyed that.
It's okay. I just missed a letter. That's all.
I think that was really interesting. And so yesterday I saw this news and I was like, well, I'm not working today, but I'm going to read this news item. And it's that I read the chart of smartphone shipments for this year and LG is number 7.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It used to be number 4 like a couple of years ago, even I think 2014.
I mean, so, all right, so the G5 not selling well. Apparently friends aren't, consumer appealing, which, you know, what do you think, Russell? Do you think this whole kind of modular thing, just taking LG, for example, and then we can talk about Dell a little bit, but do you think this is a failure on LG's part to capitalize on something that should be a nice selling point, the whole modular thing? Or is this kind of an indictment of the modular aspect that we seem to be heading down this road real fast of modular is the next thing with Android phones? Is this a sign that maybe it's not?
No, you also have to keep in mind the other weird things that happened with the LG G5. It was an expensive phone compared to, you know, just about every other phone that it was competing with. And it had a weird camera array on it to help kind of justify that cost that you know, didn't work out very well. So even like standing on its own before you even take into account the modular stuff that you would then pay more money for, the phone had some pretty interesting challenges and it just didn't compete well with especially the Galaxy S7, which was the only, you know, phone in its price bracket that it competed with at the time. And then, you know, when you take a look at the modular stuff, it was a cool idea, I think. You know, the starting lineup that they had was a little lacking, I think. But, you know, even just the camera grip stuff was really cool, but then it didn't work everywhere. Mm-hmm. AT&T users can't use any of those accessories at all. If you try and plug in the camera module to the AT&T G5, it just doesn't even turn on.
Then Motorola came in and was like, here's how you do modulars, y'all. You just snap it on the back. You don't have to take out any battery or, like, you know, break your nail trying to take the module out. It's
No so hollow body on the inside. Just slide the, you know, the component
the
into whatever.
The hollow body's kind of creepy. A little creepy.
It's a little weird. It's also, it's weirdly fragile when it's like that.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's, it definitely, you know, their implementation could have used some work, but even just standalone, the G5 had a lot of problems and price, especially this year, was a really big one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then Dell, I had to look it up because I couldn't remember exactly where I fell on the Dell, the 8-7000, because it has the kind of like the circular bar on the side and you could use it as a convertible, kind of like an Android multitasking, you know, environment with a convertible keyboard and everything like that. And I think I gave it a try only because it was a decent tablet. But if what you wanted was that kind of multitasking capability, I'm just still not sold on Android as a multitasking environment, and I just didn't think it worked as well as it probably promised. So
I loved that tablet as
really?
Far as, as far as being able to use it. And, you know, the multitasking thing, we're not going to get the software that the Dell tablet should have had until N is, you know, fully released. Mm-hmm. But the trackpad that the thing had, I wish I could put that on every Android tablet ever. You know, the fact that the Pixel C doesn't have one is unfortunate. But the other big thing to keep in mind with Dell's tablet business was they had a really strong relationship with Intel, who is no longer making the processors.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, so with them out of the picture, I'm sure that Intel was funding quite a bit of that because they were putting their RealSense cameras into it and stuff like that. So there just became a lot less reason for Dell to stay in that particular business.
Sure.
So maybe they're not selling it anymore, partially because their big partner has been like, it's not going to happen for us. We're just not going to do it anymore. Because it felt like that tablet was very much like a selling mechanism for some of the Intel technology in that space.
Yeah, very well could be. And it's all kind of also indicative of, at least to some degree, of kind of the shrinking, you know, the, I don't know, the appetite for these smart devices. Like, there will be casualties along the way. And,
absolutely.
You know, they're all battling it right now in their own ways, be it laying off executives to reorganize, being slashing the division entirely because they want to focus on other things that they think, you know, have bigger upside. And right now, smart devices is becoming more and more challenging. People have just changed their buying habits and, you know, have devices that already work and already have devices where they didn't before. So it's a different market now than it was a couple of years ago.
Unless you're Samsung.
Well, yeah, what Samsung has done is proven that, like, they are the big kahuna in the room when it comes to Android devices. And, that gets it pretty far, I think.
Well, if you make a device that, like, everybody has glowing rave reviews about and that has the most store visibility when you walk into a carrier store, like, of course that thing is going to sell really well. You know, I had to go back to the Verizon store last weekend because Verizon again cut off my service. And I had to go to a Verizon store here in New Jersey. And the lady actually, her name was Amber. She was very helpful. She put down the LG G5 as like the phone that I had in the hand because it wouldn't let me register the 6P as my phone in their system. And as she was doing that, she was saying, I love this phone so much. And I asked her and I was like, why do you like the phone? I'm like, do you like to take the things in and out of it? Like, are you? She's like, no, I just like the shape.
Well,
so
sure.
I'm not surprised because I'm sure, and I think that's kind of that's the challenge of the G5, right? Is that, you know, it kind of goes back to, is the modular thing something that everybody wants? Probably not. Some people just want a solid, you know, device. But then this is a device that has I don't know, banked its existence at least this year on that feature, and it's a pretty major feature to not care about. You know, you buy a device with this huge feature and you don't really care to use it, you just want a nice looking device or whatever, you know, that's not a big selling point for the device. So
do we think Motorola is going to have any more success with their modular devices?
That's a really good question. I don't know. I think that's where my kind of hesitancy lies a little bit as far as like trying to figure out is this a, you know, modular phones aren't necessarily the thing people want sort of thing, or is this just that LG didn't do modular right?
Well, you have to keep in mind that Motorola nailed the two big things that people are going to care about when it comes to the idea of a modular phone. The first is, you mean I can clip this thing on my back and the back of my phone and triple its battery life?
Yeah.
And the second is, you mean I can clip this thing on the back and get a way louder speaker?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and
or
so they
I can
become
clip this
simple
thing and customize
things.
It.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. There's
so
no.
It was weird that the G5 didn't do anything for battery, that they instead focused on the camera thing, which was really awkward to hold and use, and then didn't work with every G5.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it was, you know, I definitely don't think that this is an indictment on the idea of a modular phone. I think that Motorola will be a little more successful there because their implementation is nicer.
Yep. The hot, kind of the hot swapping aspect.
Smoother.
Just pop it right on. Yeah. Very curious to see that.
Ready.
Moving on to Huawei.
More phones.
What's that?
More phones.
More phones. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I thought you were still talking about the other one. Like, okay, what do you got? What do you got?
No.
Now we're going to talk about Huawei, which does not have a modular aspect to their current P9 device. But Huawei posted to Google Plus a now removed photo of a woman standing ahead of the sun in the background. Tons of detail, a nice lens flare popping in the foreground there. All around an excellent picture taken in a difficult environment. However, Google Plus makes it very easy to view the EXIF data of posted images. And doing so on this picture revealed it wasn't actually taken with the P9 as the text of the post implied. And that's to be debated, I think. But with a Canon 5D Mark III DSLR camera worth $2,600 and an attached $1,900 lens. Huawei's post said, "We managed to catch a beautiful sunrise with deliciously Ella. The Huawei P9's dual Leica cameras makes taking photos in low light conditions like this, keyword, a pleasure. Reinvent smartphone photography and share your sunrise pictures with us." No matter how you slice it, that makes it sound like this picture was probably taken with a P9. And I don't care what their PR strategy is on this, which is basically, well, yeah, we should have been a little more clear. Sorry about that. They've removed the post. They apologized for getting caught, as far as I'm concerned. What do you guys think?
On
the one hand, I don't think that there exists a smartphone company whose, you know, candid shots when they go to promote things didn't come from, you know, real big boy cameras.
Mm-hmm.
This was a shady way of presenting that.
This was super shady. That's not okay. That's like a marketing fail, quite frankly.
Yeah, they definitely should have just hit it better.
Right.
Because already, like, Chinese brands don't have a very good reputation.
Like trust.
Trustful reputation. And I just feel like this is not helping with that at all.
No, probably not.
You know? But at the same time, don't you guys think that Samsung does the same thing?
Well, that was
Samsung, Apple.
That was going to be my question. Like, do they all do this?
iPhone 6S. Yeah, I mean, right.
Well, I mean, you base your entire marketing campaign around that, which Apple has gone full board into, and board literally, because it's on billboards everywhere. So, I mean, it's not, and in Apple's case, if that were the case, and I'm not so sure that it is, I mean, that would be an insane marketing blunder if it was discovered that they were not. I think they probably are.
Right. No, you're right. But
channels there, though. Because the second avenue is you give the phone to, like, an insanely capable professional photographer.
Yeah.
And you say, go and do these things. And that's LG did that last year, where they, you know, they went on tours to different places. And there's just no way that any normal user is going to generate that photo.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. So it's... You know, it may have been shot on an iPhone, but it was shot on an iPhone by a professional photographer who then took it and edited it in $10,000 video editor or photo editing software. So,
yeah, that's a very good point. And orchestrated, you know, the lighting of the scenario and how they've mounted it, you know, all that kind of stuff. So it's not just pulling the phone out of your pocket and taking a picture.
Right.
For sure. Yeah. I don't know. It's a pretty big blunder, though. I've seen so many of these promotional photos before and wondered, like, okay, that looks really nice. Like, I feel like you see this all the time when the next big Android device is coming out or it's close to being announced and things start leaking. Is like, here's a promotional photo that was apparent, you know, found on Google Plus and taken with the image and it ends up looking good. And you're always like, yeah, but was it really, or is this just orchestrated to get us talking about it and all that kind of stuff? So it probably happens.
It could be photoshopped. I mean, people could do a little bit of a, you know, magic to it to make it look good.
Yep.
I've done with my Instagram photos.
You just admitted on a show.
Whatever.
You know what else
I want to admit, though?
Yeah.
I want to admit some Galaxy Note 7 rumors.
Do it. Get to it.
So there's actually a lot of rumors going on. I've been keeping a running tally of rumors on Greenbot, and it's getting kind of it's getting peak rumor at this point. I kind of feel like we might be at the point where we know everything about it. So we know that it's going to be called the Note 7. We're skipping the 6. We know there's only going to be one variant of the Note 7. So there's not going to be two different device launches like last year. We know they're going to have USB-C and curved edges. Actually, to be fair, we don't actually know this. We think we know, I should say. We think we know that it has a Snapdragon 823. That one's a little dubious to me, though. I'm not feeling particularly confident about that rumor. But I do think it could possibly have 6 gigs of RAM. Because, I mean, if we got the OnePlus 3 with 6 gigs, mm-hmm. why not the Note, right?
Yeah, especially because the Note is always kind of like, yeah, with those
precisely
those extra specs for sure.
Mm-hmm. Waterproofness, dustproofness, 4,000 milliamp battery pack with quick charge 3.0, finally. Should have been the Galaxy S7, quite frankly. Also, we might see that there's an iris scanner, which would make perfect sense considering, you know, past Galaxy devices have had this sort of technology in a sense. This would be a more, you know, mature version of that technology, and it would help you basically get into your system, but it's not completely off base. I could definitely see this happening.
Man, how would that work?
Not sure if we'd want to use it.
I'm not sure how that would work. Yeah, I have to see that one to believe that one. That's the one that kind of jumped out to me as like I don't know.
Yeah, so it would enable you to simply stare at the screen or your front-facing camera to unlock the phone rather than pressing and holding on the home button with your fingerprint.
It's like face unlock but tied to your eyeball? If it's an iris scanner,
For that to be functional, yeah. We'd have to have a front-facing camera that was more capable than most rear-facing cameras are now with software that handled things like image stabilization in order to capture the eye. And it would have to work in more lighting conditions than any other front-facing camera that's out right now.
Yes.
In order for it to be a reliable feature that Samsung can stand up and say, this is a thing that you can use and rely on no matter where you are. And while Samsung has dabbled with, you know, this kind of cool pet tech stuff in the past, the Samsung that we've seen over the last couple of years has been very much about polish and features that work all the time no matter where you are. And you're not going to get that with an iris scanner right now. So I'm really hesitant to believe that.
Yeah.
I'm thinking it's just going to be like sort of a half-baked feature, like a couple of phones ago, I believe it was the Galaxy S4, had a lot of like eye tracking technology in it. But I think Russell is also on a point there that the Samsung of the last 2 years has been more about polishing what it puts out because it realizes to maintain that status is number one. It needs to do that. It can't just be trying things willy-nilly like LG. Shade, man. Shin pointed out. So TouchWiz also might be getting a new look. I mean, just based on like, there was a video from an Italian website, hdblog.it, that showed some screenshots and a little run through of what the new version of TouchWiz, also referred to as Grace UX, might look like. It just looks like a cleaner version of TouchWiz. So nothing substantially different than what we have. Just, you know, a couple more tweaks here and there. Nothing about what any of the new S Pen features might be like. Nothing about whether we're still going to have like Air Command or if S Note's going to get anything new in it. That's what I'm personally most interested in. And we also know from our dear friend Evan Blass that this thing will likely be announced on August 2nd.
All right, we're entering the season.
The new season, the Nexus/
Note season.
It's a summer, autumn season of phone releases and births.
It's also fun to point out that if it has USB Type-C baked in, that means we would have to get a Gear VR refresh.
Yep.
Because it wouldn't work with the existing Samsung Gear VR.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
Yep. It wouldn't work. yeah, because it was kind of strange to not see the USB-C on the S7 and S7 Edge, but that was the reason that I guess everybody was talking about was, well, it wouldn't work with the Gear VR, and that would have to be a big change for that to happen. Although you have to imagine that at some point they would do this, right? It's the next level technology in Samsung.
Sure, this version of the Gear VR is still relatively new.
Yeah, you know, good
point. It worked with the previous version. So they could be due for a hardware refresh. We did first see the very first Gear VR with the Note 4. So it's definitely not impossible that they would go ahead and refresh it. On the other hand, they gave away a ton of those headsets with the Galaxy S7, which was not all that long ago.
Yep. So.
Take them. Please, take them.
Cool. I mean, you guys with the S7, you've got the old port. These will work for you. You've paved the way.
And they just give you all the food in their cupboard because they're like, please, take. Mm-hmm. You're my child. They're just trying to pawn it off.
I have all this new...
The Oculus ecosystem is really profitable right now. Like, app developers are doing really well in that particular store. So it's obviously working.
I imagine the parent with a cupboard full of nougat going, here, just take it. Please, just take it. Move it out. We've got a Oreos coming up here soon. By the way, somebody in chat actually, was it JJ? Thank you, JJ, pointed out that the Lumia 950 and 950 XL from last year has an iris scanner. And basically what it is when you unlock your phone, there's an infrared camera that's used to light up your eyes. And then at that same moment, a second camera takes a picture of your eyes. And so that makes it, you know, that helps it to work in different lighting conditions and stuff like that. I don't know how effective it is.
I have it right here.
Oh, well, there you go.
It works basically never.
Okay, well, there you go. So. All right. We got to the bottom of that one real quick.
Windows Phone basically working? Who knew?
Wah, wah. Okay, well, then I guess we'll see if the iris scanner thing happens. But knowing that there's somebody else doing it at least elevates it a little bit. But, yeah, maybe a good idea to not roll that out unless it's working perfectly. Because we all remember Face Unlock. That was funny.
That's annoying.
Now it's like integrated a little bit better, I think. But yeah, when it was first launched, it was just more hilarious than anything else. Other rumors. Thank you for that, Flo. Other rumors. We have the Marlin, which is basically so the ongoing rumors that we have two Nexus devices, both built by HTC, on the horizon. It's looking like both of the devices are going to be pretty much the same, except for the size and a couple of key features, basically the screen size and the battery. Other than that, the two devices, at least now, based on sources that Android Police feels pretty confident in, are going to be pretty similar. Quad-core, Qualcomm, no word on whether it's an 820 or either the rumored 821 or 823. In this case, it would be a 5.5-inch QHD AMOLED display. 12 megapixel rear facing camera, fingerprint scanner on the back, four gigs of RAM, so not 6 gigs, 3450 milliamp hour battery. The speakers are bottom firing, which is kind of what I have on the OnePlus 3 here. So they aren't doing the front facing speaker. And I'm not a huge fan of that, but whatever. I guess that's, you know.
Why are you not a huge fan of it? I'm curious.
Because when I'm looking at my device, I like the audio to hit me straight away and not shoot out the side.
Rather than have it like shoot out.
If I'm playing a game, my palm ends up cupping it, and I get a little bit of kind of like filter action happening to it. And I don't know.
But it is easier to like echo.
Yeah.
What's that? I missed that.
I was gonna say it is easier to echo the sound though.
Oh, I suppose
like in a little bowl or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, or
oh, that's a good point.
That amplifies it. So that's what I'm thinking.
That's a good point. Okay.
I also have to keep in mind that this is an HTC made phone. And if you take a look at the HTC 10, it actually uses both the front facing speaker and the bottom firing speaker.
So it could have both.
To direct audio in a kind of unique way. Mm-hmm. So it's likely, given that HTC is the manufacturer, that we'll see some of that as well.
Yeah. Very good point. Then it's kind of best of both worlds, really. And then 32 and 128 gig storage kind of options. So starting at 32, I don't think that this is like 32 all the way up to 128 along the way. I think it's, from what we're hearing right now, 32 or 128. So you've got
it's all or
decent
nothing.
Amount, or you've got insane amounts, depending on who you ask. And by the way, pretty much a couple of hours before the show, Android Police added again. They basically showed off photos of the new phones. These are reconstructed, from what I understand, based on what they've seen. So these are not promotional images that they're reposting. As far as I could gather, anyways, I think they reconstructed it. So this is pretty similar to what we can expect. No protruding camera coming out of the back. Yeah, kind of, I don't know, has a little bit of that HTC Vive, or sorry, Vibe, not the Vive. that's a different phone. I don't know, appealing? I mean, it's always appealing to me because it's a Nexus device and I'm like addicted to the Nexus devices, but what do you guys think?
I really like the HTC 10 and I'm super excited if it basically comes in Google form.
Mm-hmm.
All about it.
Yeah. That could be a lot of fun, and also, you know, this is going to be the first Google Daydream phone, which means it's going to have some pretty unique hardware in there as far as the display quality and the sensors that are in it to function with Google's Daydream VR stuff. So it's going to be capable in a way that we haven't seen other Android phones be, just from a included hardware perspective, which is exciting.
Very good point. Excellent. All right. Well, we probably won't have to wait very long to find out more about those because I think probably within the next couple of months, I have to imagine there's going to be some sort of timed announcement / release of the official version of Nougat and the new devices. That'll probably be kind of the harbinger of them, you know, bring them to the table for the most part. But I could be wrong. You never know. Google might do things a little bit differently this time around. We have an email, Flo.
We do have an email. I love getting emails from you guys. Please keep sending us emails. So this email is from Rob W. He asks, I completed my contract on a Nexus 4 a few years ago and am looking to move on. I am looking to purchase a sub-$400 Android phone with a good, parentheses, great, LOL, parentheses closing, camera. Any recommendations?
Sorry, I just snorted. I don't know how that happened.
Rob didn't know if he should be asking for good or great. I mean, I think he's still stuck in the Nexus 4 world when,
that's a
you
good
know,
point.
Android cameras were kind of iffy.
Mm-hmm. And $400 wasn't going to get you a whole lot. And now $400 gets you a lot. What do you think, Russell? Do you have any good kind of recommendations in the sub-$400 range?
I mean, it's kind of hard to go wrong with the 5X if you're already used to that kind of Nexus experience. On the other hand, there's some pretty good stuff happening with OnePlus, which is also kind of similar to that experience. So really, I think you'd be okay with either one of those or, you know, you could wait like a month or two.
Yeah.
Rob, just wait.
I think that's probably, that was going to be just one of my recommendations is at least just hold out for another month or two. And I always hate saying that because we have a history on this show for just always telling people, just wait a couple of more months because the next thing's right around the corner. You could do that for your entire life. But at least we know in the next couple of months that there will be a new crop of Nexus devices. So if updates are important to you and you are a Nexus user in the past, that might be worth waiting for if you can hold out for another couple of months. And then, you know, Samsung's I mean, that's not going to be under $400, though. But, you know, at least for the Nexus devices, maybe
you
hold
can pay for half of one for $400.
Yes. Pay now $400 and then $400 next year.
Subsidize.
Yeah, you can do subsidize. I know I'm enjoying a phone, which this is the OnePlus 3. I've been using it now. I don't know. I've had it all through my vacation, you know, probably a couple of weeks now, 2.5, going on 3 weeks, I'm guessing. And I know I'm using a phone that I like when my time with it is pretty much done, but I just can't be bothered to, like, remove my SIM and go back to my other device. Like, it's the easiest thing in the world to take the SIM out of here, just pop it out and put it in the other device. But I keep using it. Why do I keep using it? Because I actually really enjoy it. It's a really great phone, and I'm really liking it. And this is $400. It's like $399. So, you know, you save yourself a dollar.
Or £329 if you're in the UK.
Yeah.
After July 11th.
Definitely do the conversion there and see what works for you. But, yeah, it's a great phone. So you have choices. $400 is a great price range these days, and it's a good time to buy. So hopefully that works for you. Let's take a minute and thank a sponsor of today's episode before we move along, and that would be Tracker, sponsors of this episode. Smart cars, smart phones, smart homes. We've got all sorts of smart things, smart people. Technology's made everything smart, but when you lose those things that you carry with you, your possessions, that can make you feel not so smart at all. Well, that's what Tracker is all about. I have a Tracker tucked away in my backpack because I don't have a smart backpack. Well, that's the beauty of Tracker. I carry a lot of, you know, things in my backpack that I don't want to lose. And so I just tuck this in a pocket that I never use. It stays there in the corner. It just kind of hangs out, and it's constantly tracking my backpack. So if I leave without it, or if it leaves without me, more importantly, then I know, and I can actually track it. It's a super cool technology here. You just pair a tracker to your smartphone, attach it to any item like I have, and you find its precise location with a tap of the button. It's really that easy. You can customize two-way separation alerts, so you'll receive notifications before you forget your item. And then, of course, if you lose your phone, it works in the other direction. You just press the tracker button, and your phone is going to ring. I'll go ahead and do that here. See? You get a little audio feedback. And when it's synced to your phone is going to ring even if it's muted, and you'll be able to find it, you know, tucked away in the cushions of the couch where you always find your missing phone when you're trying to leave the house. With over 1.5 million devices, Tracker has the largest crowd GPS network in the world, so your lost item shows up on a map even if it's miles away. The Tracker app records your lost item's last known location on a map, and then when another Tracker user comes within 100-foot range of your item, you'll get a GPS update of your item's location. Your phone can track up to 10 devices at one time. Tracker is enabled by Bluetooth low energy, so the battery lasts up to 1 year. It's not going to run out of that precious battery juice. Water-resistant cases are also available for purchase, and that's perfect for things like, you know, putting a tracker on your pet collar. Or your pet's pet collar, maybe not yours, but theirs. You can even add a laser engraved message to each Tracker Bravo, like return or pet information. Tracker recently introduced Tracker Atlas. It works with your Tracker Bravo or third-party Bluetooth tracker to pinpoint your items on a customizable floor plan of your home. You can save time and energy. All you got to do is simply ask Tracker Atlas where your item is, and you'll instantly get an answer. You don't need to search anymore. Never lose a thing again, no matter where it happens to be. The hardest thing you'll ever have to do is find their website. Go to thetracker.com. You'll never lose your possessions again. Plus, just for our audience, if you enter promo code AAA, you're going to get 30% off your entire order. That's thetracker, thetracker.com. Promo code AAA for 30% off your entire Tracker order. And we thank Tracker for their support of All About Android and the TWiT Network. All right, we've got a couple of cool app stories, so let's check them out. All right, I know I'm kind of happy to see this, and Russell, and I know this might pique your interest as well. Google announced at I/O this year that family sharing was coming to apps and games that are purchased on Google Play. Looks like it's starting to take shape. At least the Google Play developer distribution agreement has been updated to reflect the upcoming changes. So basically how it's going to work is one person is going to manage the family group, and then at that point, I could purchase, let's say if I'm the manager of the family group, I could purchase an app or a game, and I can share that with the family group. So we don't have to buy, you know, the app every time for every user. They're part of the group. They get it. It does not apply retroactively, apparently. So if you've made purchases prior to this switch, it won't apply to that unless the developer has specifically gone in and granted it. So developers are going to have to do some action in order to get in on that. And there are also exclusions for things like subscriptions and in-app purchases, which might bum some people out that you can't share your coins and stuff, but that's just the way it is. But I think this is good. I like the approach that Google's doing with this stuff for families to kind of spread it out. Is there any damage to developers for this? I mean, is there anything way to stop somebody from signing up for a family account and then sharing it with friends as opposed to family? I couldn't gather that.
No, but at the same time, I think that that's probably a fairly low risk, as we've seen on other platforms that have been doing this for a couple of years.
Yeah.
So it's probably not going to be a bad, you know, rub for those developers. I think the number that they're going to miss is going to be pretty low.
Yeah. Cool. Well, I think this is good. Definitely a good way to kind of share it around a little bit, especially like with games, because if you have a family and you buy a game, it's nice. Everybody can play it and be on the same, play together. So there you go. And Maps Flow. I love this feature.
Yes. So Google is finally rolling out a highly requested feature to Google Maps that allows for planning multiple stops. I am super excited about this because, as you remember, I think we actually showcased a couple apps in the arena that helped you do this because this wasn't natively built into Google Maps. So it's a server-side switch. So if you don't see it yet, you know, you have to wait. It's coming to you. But all you have to do is tap the overflow menu as you would to, you know, say, find a CVS on your way.
I had it, and then it went away. Let's see here. We'll go to work. Yeah, I had it.
I want to see if you can explain it before I
show a screen because I don't want to reveal some stuff because it's all my map stuff. Whatever. The overflow would be up there next to one of those X's. I totally had it. And then right when you took the screenshot, I got rid of it accidentally. I'm like, no. But there you go.
I love this.
That's what you get.
I'm super excited for this. This really would have come in handy, you know, when I started traveling Europe as a broke college student. But that was then. This is now. It'll be helpful for road trips.
Yeah.
You know, or just making a stop along the way. You know, I got to stop at somebody's house along the way to the freeway or whatever. So... Google, always making maps better than it was yesterday.
It's true. Maps is one of my favorite Google products, at least on Android, because I use it
constantly.
It's
the reason I still am on Android.
Yeah, it's a pretty big feature for sure, and this is one of those things that I've been wanting for literally years. There are developers that have created apps that do this sort of thing, and you know, I'm sure they've done it well, but it's nice to have it integrated into the thing you're already using.
Yeah, and the bummer was it only worked with the web client.
Right.
For so long. So mm-hmm. I would like, you know, try and plan tourist days when I was visiting a place. And I basically had to print out the map and put it inside a folder and carry it with me.
Isn't that funny? I can't remember the last time I had to do that, but it was recent enough that I told it was within the last year that I had no choice and I had to do that. And it was so foreign. I remember when that was just the way it was. Like, I need to get to there. I'm going to MapQuest, printing out my directions. So strange.
Ay, ay, ay.
So, yes.
Kids will never know what it's like to be a new driver without, like, the help of maps. Because when I was a new driver, like, getting around even to my little suburban town, like, I just didn't understand where anything was relative to each other for whatever reason.
Yeah.
I had a lot of paper maps.
I mean, I'm to the point now where, like, even here, Petaluma is not a very big town, and I've lived here long enough to know, like, what street is where, and I'm just dumb because I just navigate to places. I'm like, oh, I don't know. This will tell me how to get there quicker because I rely on it because it ends up telling you how to get there faster than maybe the normal route because of traffic and all that kind of stuff. So just keeps getting better. This is something that you both have experience with, and I have absolutely zero experience, so I'll go ahead and introduce it and say that Pokemon Go, the follow-up, the next app by the makers of, Niantic Labs, essentially, is available now. It literally launched, like, right before the show. Like, would this, actually, Brian, would this be breaking news? I'm sorry to throw this on you. We're just watching a promo with Taya Leone, but... Yeah, we got to update that one.
Actually, I want to know what Tay Leone is doing now.
We missed it. It was on the promo. We missed it. Breaking news bumper overshadows Tay Leone. It's true. But yeah, so Pokemon Go, you guys have been playing this for a little while, at least the beta anyways. What are your thoughts?
Russell, I'm going to let you take this first.
Sure. I was an Ingress player for a while, so I kind of had a lot of the core idea behind the game already set. They've taken a lot of really interesting things about, you know, the Pokemon universe, if you've ever played any of the games not in card form, and kind of rolled them into an augmented reality game where you walk around in the real world and you catch Pokemon and then you can take them to places that are set up as gyms and, battle them against other players or against other Pokemon that are at those gyms. It's kind of wild the way that they've got it set up. And if you're a fan of, you know, the Pokemon universe and you have a phone, then it stands to reason that you would enjoy this.
What do you think, Flo? Have you had fun with this? Did you play?
I did have some fun with it. And like Russell and I were talking about it before the show. And it's one of those fun games that you can like play when you're commuting or as you're like walking places or whatever, but I just, maybe it's because I'm an adult. I'm just not, I kept forgetting to like whip it out of my pocket when I would like go places. So,
It commanded too much of your attention while you're out and about.
A lot of time, but also, like, because I was using the beta, it was kind of glitchy a little bit on my Nexus 6P. Mm-hmm. So I was having some issues with that. So I don't know. I think I'm gonna play it a little bit more. And like I said before the show started, I like the ability to kind of jump into a game like Pokemon TCGO versus this, because I feel like once you whip out the phone and you start like capturing Pokemon, I don't know, you got to commit to it a little bit.
Yes.
And sometimes when I'm walking like to work or whatever, I don't want to commit to an app. I just kind of want to keep going about my day. So
zone out.
Yeah, precisely.
That would be my problem. That was my my challenge with Ingress, is that, you know, when I was out and about walking around, it just never occurred to me to launch up the game and kind of, you know, see what was along the path that I was going, or even to just to go out with the specific idea of playing the game. It just never clicked for me, but it clicked for a lot of people. And so I imagine this series will probably do the same. To some degree. I don't know if it's the same people. Maybe it's a little bit younger audience. I'm not sure. But it looks cool. I appreciate what it's doing. We continue to get video mail, and that's awesome, Flo. I don't know what to say.
So
to throw
we've got a...
This is the worst throw of the world. There you go.
So we've got a video question regarding the maturation. I can never say that word well. Of apps for Android. So let's get to it.
Hi, Triple A crew.
Hey.
Big fan of the show. Mm-hmm. I was thinking the other day, give it a couple of good hours of thought, actually, that there doesn't appear to be any non-covered categories in apps. There are a lot of apps, and, you know, they all seem to be sort of improving on things that came before them. Word processing, photo editing, weather, all of those things, but they're just sort of variations on a theme. Are there any ideas, any things that aren't being done that maybe somebody who's enterprising and had some programming skill might do and create a whole new category of app? I know that's kind of a broad thing, but it was something that occurred to me. Anyways, I'm a big fan of the show. Keep up the good work. And I'll be thinking about it some more later.
Excellent.
Bye. I really love this philosophical question just got sent to us, by the way. Unfortunately, I have no idea how to answer it, because I feel like we come into this issue where we don't even know like what kinds of apps to bring into the, you know, we're just running out of, I don't know. I don't want to say running out of ideas, because that sounds so uninspired, but...
Well, no, I understand exactly what you're saying, because it's a challenge that we are increasingly having week after week, which is that, you know, the big obvious kind of missing categories of apps are full, or are being filled, let's say.
Yeah.
Emphasis on apps seems to be kind of dying down a little bit. You know, we keep hearing these stories about how people aren't, you know, they aren't using or downloading or using apps to the same degree that they were, you know, a couple of years ago. It's like we have the apps that we have, and I don't know what that means about the kind of broad app ecosystem. There's still great apps out there. If I knew the answer to this question, then I would probably want to, like, you know, strike up a relationship with a really great developer and create it, because maybe that's an opportunity that's currently being missed. And I think that's just a big challenge for developers. I don't know what the answer is there, but I think more and more, it's just more and more difficult to kind of strike gold as far as that's concerned and find a concept or find an app or even a new kind of approach to an app that already exists that hasn't been done before. Do you think, Russell, do you think the kind of the introduction of material design, let's say, for example, over the last couple of years has been good for this, or maybe not as good for this because it kind of homogenized the playing field a little bit?
I think the whole point of material design was to offer kind of structure where there wasn't. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's more about taking existing designs and giving them kind of cohesion. But as far as new designs, I mean, we have to kind of think about what it is that we want apps to do in the first place. And for the longest time, apps on our phones were taking, you know, PC-bound tasks or, you know, kind of lifestyle tasks. And it became a race to see which interface was best for those things. And they're not really you know, new things that were being done, just new implementations on things that we knew that we wanted. And so, you know, to answer the question, you really kind of have to figure out what it is you want your phone to do that it's not already doing.
Yeah.
And for a lot of people, that, you know, it's a task manager and a communication tool and not a whole lot else. You know, we've recently, and I say recently, but it's been over the last couple of years, have found that photography has been, you know, kind of the next big thing that we can do with these phones that we wouldn't ordinarily have done, either because of price or because of a lack of skill. And you know, that quickly became saturated. So it's really more about what the kind of next push that you think your phone should be doing, you know, aside from serving as an entertainment device, would be.
That is a hard question to answer. I have mm-hmm. no idea what my phone could do for me next. What more could your phone do for you? I don't know. Turn into a car?
What could phone do for you?
that's like the whole push into these virtual assistants and the artificial intelligence that drives them is where we've now reached a point where we know what we want these phones to do. Now we want them to do them faster. And in some cases, we want them to happen without our even asking for it. You know, so that it's you know, kind of taking context from around us and doing the things for us. And so, you know, it quickly becomes how few times can I push a button on my phone to get something done, which isn't new. It's just a continued push to where we were 5 years ago, where we were, you know, this, I don't want to use my computer for this thing. I want to use my phone for this thing. And so now we're getting that next step is I want to push fewer buttons to do the same things.
Mm-hmm. And have my phone know me well enough to know what I want to do and, yeah.
Right.
And make it easier. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. That's challenging because, the trend right now seems to be, you know, artificial intelligence and AI kind of tackling those tasks. And that's not necessarily always within the grasps of any developer out there. But that really seems to be kind of the flow of things right now as far as this is concerned. But yeah, if you guys can, if you think about like a category of app that doesn't exist or something that you've always wanted, this would be a really interesting feedback to get from you guys. We'll read it on the show or, you know, do a video mail with your answer or whatever. AAA@twit.tv. Let us know what's missing from the App Store or from the Google Play Store at this point. Is there anything that you've been waiting for that just isn't appearing, or is it just less important to you now? Maybe there's a different focus is important to you. AAA.
I'm going to think about this too. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good question.
I think I would want like a social creation tool. Like, how cool would it be if you had random people contributing to, say, a book? You know,
like
where
everyone, thing.
Yeah, where mm-hmm. where, you know, it was not necessarily a live thing, but, you know, this person wrote, you know, half a chapter on a thing, and you could go in and kind of contribute, and it was kind of approved by the group, you know, as it came in, and so the end result was this story that was told by, you know, 30 people from 30 perspectives, and it was all happening on this tool. And when the story is done, it can then be shared with the world. I think that would be really
socialist
neat.
Storytelling.
Yeah.
There's the name of your app.
Yeah, that'll get the downloads.
Everyone will want this.
All right. Hopefully that was a good enough answer. We danced around the answer kind of because there is no easy answer. But do let us know what you think. AAA@twit.tv. All right. It is time to review some apps that we were just talking about in the arena.
So many enter, but only one lives. Android Arena.
All right. Let's see here. I was out last week. But I want to take a look, and Smart Wallpaper wins with 38%, followed by Beneath the Lighthouse at 35% and Mobile Passport at 27%. Flo, which one was yours?
Mine was Beneath the Lighthouse, which I believe is that a Cranky Hippo screen there?
That is Cranky Hippo. Yes.
Because that means he voted for it.
I did. It was the best one of the last winter.
But not enough. It's too bad that Brian's vote doesn't count for 10 or 20 votes, as it really should. Really. But you know what, Flo? It doesn't matter because you are... Oh, actually, before we get into the new apps, Wade County, thank you very much. We have the tabulations through week 26. I am at 7. Flo, you are at 7. Ron is at 6. Guests are at 6. It's never been this close.
Between and all four.
Also, we're in week 26. Also, that's just another thing to put in there, that we are in week 26 of the year.
We're like halfway through the year, and everybody has almost equal wins. So literally,
we're exactly halfway through the year, actually.
That's crazy. This is crazy. I love it.
Pretty intense.
Everybody, you know, you can't rest on your laurels in this game. The arena is brutal like that. And you've got a lot of pressure on you, Russell. But you're going to have to wait because, let's see here. Flo is the returning champ, so she goes last. That means I go first because I wasn't here last week. Mine's pretty easy to kind of show off here. Let me get out of maps, which is where I was before. So what if an app wouldn't launch until you've done enough exercise for any given day? That is kind of the idea behind Step Lock. So I've assigned Step Lock. So basically Step Lock, what does it do? It taps into your phone to recognize how many steps you've taken every day. And you can assign apps to certain levels of steps. So for example, Fallout Shelter, I have unblocked at 100, not because I've think that's all the steps I'm going to take, but because that would enable me to show you how it's unblocked at this point. But so I've done, let's see here, since I started the app earlier today, it's probably this, you know, like noon or whatever, I've taken 577 steps. Don't harsh me. I've been working on a lot of shows and doing a lot of sitting, but there you go. 577 steps. At 100, my access to Fallout Shelter was unblocked. So that opens the doors. If I wanted to go in and increase it, I can. And I can also, with the premium version, I think it's a $1.99 upgrade inside the app, I can assign different ratings for different days. So let's say I want to take the weekend off. I want my weekends to be completely unrestricted, but I want my weekdays. I'm not going to play Fallout Shelter until I walk 1,000 steps. I'll go ahead and do that. And boom, it's unblocked at 1,000. Even if I wanted to, let's hope it demonstrates properly, I would launch it and it would say, no, I'm sorry, you can't do that. 423 more steps to unlock Fallout Shelter. I've locked myself out. Sure, there are ways around it. You got to have a little bit of self-control so that you don't go into Step Lock and just lower it and whatever, get in. But hey, I have faith in you that you're going to hold yourself accountable for the amount of steps that you want to take in order to play Fallout Shelter. And there you go. It's called Step Lock. It's pretty, you know, pretty simple app. It's designed nicely. It looks, you know, it's got the whole material design thing going on for the most part here. And I can jump in and it gives me all of my apps and I can assign different step ratings for different apps. So, you know, maybe this is a way to curb your Facebook addiction. It'll force you to get out and walk instead. It's called Step Lock, walk and unblock apps. And there you go. There's a free version. There's a more unrestricted version that allows you to do unlimited apps and kind of change, you know, how it works on the weekends versus the weekdays and all that for, I think, $1.99, I believe it is. $1.49, sorry. So there you go. You get a deal. Step Lock. Excellent. All right. So that is my app. Russell, I have yours installed. This is going to be interesting. Is there going to be a little bit of back and forth here? Go ahead and talk about it, and we'll see if we can get it connected.
Yeah. So my app is VTime, and it's actually a virtual environment that allows for up to four people to jump into a kind of a social room together and talk. This works with either Google Cardboard, or if you have a Samsung phone, it'll work with the Gear VR, or just this kind of magic window mode where it just gives you a window into this virtual environment. But the whole idea is that you can, you know, have friends that are in the virtual environment, and you can go through and, you know, jump into a room with them and have actual conversations, like voice conversations. And inside those virtual environments, you can share photos, including 360-degree photos, which is a super cool way of doing that. To share so that, you know, everyone in the environment can kind of look around and see. It's just kind of, you know, neatly social.
Where are you? I know that we are added. And I've got all these things like here. So let's see here. So close that one. It was like you were here for a second. And then I got inundated by all these other people in here.
All of these other bubbles. These other
people.
Time
to make new friends.
I know. Apparently I need to make new friends. But I want to just find you. So how do I do
that? There we go. Hang on. I'm going to join the room that you're in.
There we go. I think I found you. Yeah. Allow. Okay.
And so now I will be sitting in one of the chairs, and I can see you.
Oh, you can. Okay, so let me get out of here.
So if you turn your phone. then you'll see my avatar over to the right of you.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to show off because it's meant for VR, although I can do it in the standalone mode. You can see, I'm trying to show it to you while still rotating, but there's Russell.
And as I'm talking, the microphone picks up and the software will, you know, start to do hand gestures and mouth gestures where it looks like I'm talking and doing things, you know, basically, you know, in this kind of conversation format. And you can change, you know, how the environment looks. And there's like a neat underwater one that you can do. And
yeah, let's see if I can change the environment and maybe it'll position you differently. So let's destinations. Let's go to the boardroom.
The boardroom, very professional.
Yeah, we're going to have a nice meeting here. I played with this a couple. There we go. That's better. And there you are. Yeah. And new feature. Okay. You can share 2D panorama. Okay. So there's Russell sporting the flip-flops, hanging out in the boardroom.
Oh, God.
And as I'm moving the phone, it moves my head around. So when you have this as, you know, cardboard or something, it's actually positioned, it, you know, tracks position to your head.
Yep.
And as you talk, the hands and movement, and you have got really white hair.
Yeah, I've got really, I was just, yes, and pale skin. This is me. It's kind of hard to see, but without a head, because my head is me, basically. You know, this was a very interesting experience for me. When I first played around with this, I think I played around with it on Android App Arena a couple of months ago on a VR-focused episode. And when I went into it, I expected to just kind of be like, oh, yeah, okay, that was interesting, moving on. But it was so, like, strangely engaging to end up in this virtual room when you've got kind of the VR thing going on. And you're having a conversation, and the hands are moving around and all this kind of stuff. You hear the person talking on the other side. So when you see their hands moving, you also hear the voice coming from that side, you know, in your stereo headphones. And it was just really crazy. It kind of blew my mind. It felt like the future, I suppose. I don't know if this is the future, but it felt like the future.
And because you're in this boardroom here, you actually have this giant window over. You're probably not going to be able to pan to it. Where photos can be shared on the big wall there. So if you've got, you know, a photo that you want to share.
Oh, yeah, I can't show that off. It's behind me.
Put it up on the big wall. And there are other environments where you can do that with a photosphere that you've taken or a 360-degree photo that can be shared up there.
So you can see it.
It's really kind of a neat way of, you know, sharing in this kind of giant virtual environment.
Yeah,
and you can do it right now. It's limited to 4 people, but you can have, you know, random people come in and join and meet new friends and talk to them, or you can just have your friends come in and join. And it's a very cool way of doing this, I thought.
Yeah, I agree. Very kind of immersive too, depending on the environment. You've got one. Oh, and Russell's gone. You can be out in space. You can be hanging out in a cave. I thought this one was really cool, around a cave fire. So you're in a cave. And you've got a little fire kind of burning in the center. And of course, the way it fired up is that you're just going to see rocks. So that's the challenge. Oh, there's the fire a little bit. Worth checking out, especially on cardboard. Although you can use it without cardboard. But as you can see, it's just hard for me to show off. Because, you know, it's kind of this forced perspective sort of thing.
If you have Google Cardboard or if you have a Gear VR, it's free on both of those. And it's a lot of fun to try out.
Yeah. It is very cool. VTime for Google Cardboard. And check out the future. This is the future, man. all right. So, Flo, I've got yours installed as well. I will show that off.
Thanks, Jason.
You're welcome.
Such a great help today.
No problem.
We're all virtually here with you. So I've been doing a lot of fun stuff at home with networking. You know, we've got this. I've been testing the Echo WeBoost, or the WeBoost Echo, I should say, and I needed to find an app that can help me test these things. And then I kind of got obsessed with testing the differences in signal between like the AT&T and the T-Mobile and the Verizon phones that I have. So I was really surprised that OpenSignal wasn't yet mentioned in the
nice
app arena. This app is fantastic. It's basically your all-in-one tool for testing your cellular and Wi-Fi connectivity. And I mean, it gives you everything you could possibly need. It tells you how many decibels you've got going on with your signal. It tells you where the nearest antenna towers are for your, there you go, Jason, your nearest towers.
Let's see here. T-Mobile.
Stats. Yeah, there you go.
Show me my T-Mobile.
There you go. And then, you know, you point your phone that way and it works perfectly. It lets you know how you're doing on data, lets you know how strong your Wi-Fi signal is. There's even like, there's a couple of extra neat things. For instance, there's a live wallpaper that comes with it, for instance, which will show you like your connection live as it's happening, which is kind of neat. There's also an included widget. You can save data to your SD card if you were using it for professional purposes. And you know, the best thing about the app is that it's totally free and ad-free.
Mm-hmm. It's like it's not pulling in the right data for the live wallpaper. Excellent.
Whoopsie.
Advanced. Ooh, I get even more features with advanced on. Always go advanced. Once you go advanced, you'll never go back.
By the way, so in my own testing, this is completely apropos of nothing, but the Twit Studios has really good cell service.
Inside the studio? Yeah. I mean, it can. Yeah. Wi-Fi can be a little tricky around here because we've got so many things interfering and everything. But yes, this studio is the perfect place to test apps like this. For sure.
It is, which is why I ran into so many problems when I was testing stuff at home and I needed to find an app to help. So when you go back to the main screen, the dashboard, that little arrow is your little indicator of where the cell tower is located.
Oh, I thought it was just pointing at Brian at the TV desk.
Well,
it was just like, Brian's over there.
Brian's full of signal. He's radioactive.
Wow, so you are a strong signal, Brian. I'm really quite impressed.
Yeah, it's pretty typical.
Also, there are Wi-Fi maps included. So if you need help, like you're somewhere and you need to figure out where the heck there's free Wi-Fi, this thing will help you out. This is just a great, great helper app. It's a nice utility.
Nice. I like it. I like it a lot. And it's designed well. Looks great. And excellent. So it's called Open Signal, and it is free. No, like, pro or upgrade requirement on that. No, it doesn't look like it. It's just free.
Free and ad-free.
Excellent. All right, so look for Open Signal in the Play Store, and you will find it. All right, so we have three apps this week for you to vote on, and it's time for you to do that. Go to bit.ly/AAAshow273. I've pinned it to the top of the community this week. Sorry about that. It's hard to remember all the different ways that we put this poll out there. bit.ly/AAAshow273. Place your vote. Is your favorite Step Lock, VTime for Google Cardboard, or Open Signal? Place your vote. We'll check in on it next week, and we'll go from there. But that is about it for this week. Before we kind of round things out, just real quick here, many of our Twit listeners have participated in our annual Twit audience survey we do every year. We do it. That was at the beginning of the year. It was helpful feedback, super valuable on our programming, our advertising practices, all the stuff that we do here. Our partner, PodTrack Analytics, is currently asking avid podcast fans, including Twit listeners, of course, to chime in and provide anonymous information about the trends and needs of podcast audiences. So if you're interested, you want to participate, it would certainly help out in PodTrack's audience panel. All you got to do is visit podtrack.com/panel. That's PodTrack. .com/panel for more information. And they really appreciate it if you choose to do that. So thank you. But that is it for this week. And Russell, always a pleasure getting you on the show. It had been far too long. I will not let it be this long for the next time. But I love your take on all these topics. And I love that you're focused on VR right now, because that just sounds like a lot of fun. So thank you
very much. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah. So finally, just, I guess, let people know what they need to know about all the work that you're doing.
Yeah. So, I mean, everything with VR heads, it doesn't really matter what kind of virtual reality is. It's stuff that I'm constantly playing with and constantly fascinated by. So if you're a Google Cardboard user or a Gear VR user, or you're considering a PlayStation VR or an Oculus Rift or any of those, come talk to me, ask whatever questions you have. I'm more than willing and happy to answer anything that I can.
Fantastic. VRheads.com, at Russell Holly on the Twitter and all around. Thanks again, Russell. All right. And Flo, what you up to?
Well, this week, you know, reviewing the Xperia X performance. I'm working on that right now.
Excellent.
I got a lot of reviews in the pipeline, guys. I got a lot of phones on my desk right now back in San Francisco. So stay tuned for that. You can find all that on PCWorld.com, Greenbot.com. And of course, I Snapchat a lot and I Twitter a lot and you can, or tweet. And you can find that at OThatFlow on both.
Excellent. Your clock behind you says 1:27. It's not really 1:27 in the morning, is it?
No. Okay. My bestie just has never changed the clock for some reason.
Okay. All right. I was worried there. I was like, wait a minute. It's time warp. Thank you, Flo. Brian, what about you?
Well, I guess I did screensavers last weekend, but typically I don't do that anymore. But I sometimes submit tips for the screensavers every Saturday. I do know-how with Padre, and this last couple weeks we've been focusing on how to stay cool on the cheap, so how to build your own AC, basically. And yeah, you can follow me on Twitter @cranky_hippo.
Excellent. Thank you for all that you do with the show. You are very on point when playing the breaking news bumper, for example.
Yeah.
That is just one of your highlights, Brian.
Are we going to change that?
I think we are. I think I have a lot of work to do between now and next. Here's the challenge. Actually, this is what I really want to hear from people. Songs about nougat. There are lots of songs about things like marshmallow and lollipop or whatever, but I don't think there are any songs about nougat that we can smash into a breaking news bumper.
I wonder if Ron knows any like Italian songs or something about nougat, like folk song.
I think you're going to have to make a nougat song on your next album or something. Oh, we'll just use it for the show.
I'm going to make a song about nougat. I don't even like nougat, but I think I have to. Ryan, so anyways.
We've got to find a sampler of nougat to get you, so you can just try.
I should just order it. I mean, I could probably do that.
Yeah, let's order it. We should have a taste test on the show.
All right. Next week.
Okay. Yes.
Am I here next week? Yes, we're all here next week. Yes. We will have some nougat on hand for us to eat. And maybe we'll send some to Ron, too, because he'll be in New York. But anyways, about.me/Jason Howell. Find my music and maybe a song about nougat someday at yellowgoldmusic.com. But that is it for this week. Thank you so much for joining us, as always. Leave us a voicemail, 347-SHOW-AAA. Send us an email at AAA@twit.tv or a video mail. Let's keep them coming. I love what we're getting this every single week. It's awesome. We are on Twitter. We're @AndroidShow. We are on Reddit, twitaaa.reddit.com. Show notes and past episodes can always be found at twit.tv/AAA. That's our home on the web. We also have our episodes everywhere that you expect to find them, YouTube, iTunes, everywhere. And you can catch us live for all the insanity on Tuesdays around 5:30 p.m. Pacific at twit.tv/live. That's it for this week. We'll see y'all next week on another episode of All About Android. Bye, y'all. Boom, boom.
So, did you see any of that chat? There's been a mouse running around this apartment or this house.
I saw it run by, really. It was really weird.
Oh my God, Brian!
Sorry.
Sorry. That was too convincing. That was awesome.
I spent way too much time in the background working on that.
Mouse behind me, and I thought it was the real thing, and I freaked out.
Whoops.
So great.
God.
That was really good.
Trolling me.
I considered bringing it up during the show, but I really didn't want to freak you out, depending on how phobic you are.
I was trying really hard to save Sister's face.
Oh, that was so great. Don't think that that isn't going in the after credits roll. We don't do that a lot. What I love is you perfectly like masked it so that it.
I had to crop flow a little. I mean, it's not perfect, but in. At speed, it goes all right.
That's awesome.